we talk about the present situation of Surat, then the, right now the world's 90% diamonds are cut and polished there. So it is a very important part of the diamond circuit, which goes through Tel Aviv and Moscow. At that time, if some conversion happens, then it was impossible to get them back. And there was so much social disdain for the people who converted. So one among them committed suicide later. This Mahajan started building pressure on Aurangzeb that you need to apologize. You need to take surety of our religious freedom. If this doesn't happen, then we are going to execute our all threats through Baru. He was also the first Indian entrepreneur to purchase the machineries regarding the printing press for quote-unquote the common good of printing quote-unquote ancient manuscript that could be useful or at least grateful to posterity in 1674 to 1675. This is a bit introduction from my side. So I'm an R&D engineer by day and a learner by moonlight. So that's my part-time job to learn about things. I'm an alumnus of NIT and I occasionally write articles which appear in News 18, Swarajya, Firstpost, WION, etc. When I'm not solving the complex engineering problems, I would be seen reading books, capturing moment through my lines or traveling or tracking the financial markets. I'm interested in history, entrepreneur and mercantile in particular, finance, geopolitics and international relations and Gujarati literature. My views and activities can be stalked on Twitter and Instagram at Harshil. So that was a bit introduction about myself. So the question comes why I chose this topic and why I'm speaking on this topic. So there are two particular answers. The first one is that the history of economy and the trade is generally neglected. When we discuss about the history, it is mostly about the kings and the wars they fought. It is generally not about the merchants and the trade wars which they dealt with. So a good history can be understood with a focus on the entrepreneurship and trade. Like how were the people-to-people relations? How was the culture? Which things were in the demand? Which things led to the struggle between the kingdoms? The second one reason why I chose this topic is the importance of merchants and traders throughout the history. It is often been downplayed by the historians. When we talk about the Marxists, they have a natural disdain for the merchants and the traders. But when we talk about some other historians, then they focus on the spiritual and the political conquest, but they often neglect the economic conquest and the economic power. So these are the two main motivations why I chose to give a talk on this topic. So this whole event occurred in Surat, the diamond city of India. So let us have some introduction about the city. What is the, where it is located? What is the bit of history about it? And what were the political situation when this event took place? This one is the present Surat. As you can see here on the southern part of Gujarat, on the bank of Tapti River, around 250 kilometers south to Ahmedabad and the same kilometers north to Mumbai, the Surat is situated. So if we talk about the present situation of Surat, then the, right now the world's 90% diamonds are cut and polished there. So it is a very important part of the diamond circuit, which goes through Tel Aviv and Moscow. Presently, rupees 5 billion industry of textiles is situated in Surat. Surat is also famous for its zari craft and silk. It is also a hub for the automobile and electronics equipment. Also, it is situated on the near to sea, so it makes it a natural hub for the companies to come and establish their industrial centers. So if we talk about big companies like L&T, Reliance, and all, they have their centers in Surat. So Surat is a thriving city, an industrial city, also a commercial city in Gujarat. So it holds so much importance. It has been the case since for the very long period. It is not that it is new. So let us dwell something into the past. So if we talk about the Surat pass, so I have, for the sake of simplicity, I have divided it into the four parts: Delhi Sultanate, Gujarat Sultanate, Mughal Dynasty, and British Dutch and others. So when Gujarat fell to allow the Khilji in 1297, naturally Surat fell to him. But proper governors were not appointed until 1347. It happened by Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So this continued for something 50-60 years. One such governor was there, whose name was Governor Jafar Khan, who was from the Muzaffarid dynasty. He declared the independence in 1407, and Gujarat Sultanate was established. And at that time, the Rajputs of Baglana were given the contract of collecting taxes in Surat and collecting customs and etc. Fell to the business of Rajputs of Baglana. Then the Mughal dynasty came, particularly at the Akbar conquest of Gujarat. Mughals annexed it in 1538, but Surat was still not much focus of Mughals. But when Aurangzeb fully annexed it 100 years later, that was the time when the Rajputs of Baglana were totally annexed. The kingdom was annexed, and it Surat became a hub for the Mughals. So we are this event, we are talking about this event around this time, that 50 years after this Aurangzeb full annexation happened. Then again, when the Mughals were ruling Surat, at that time, the Dutch, French, British, and all these trading communities were executing their trades in Surat. If we talk that Armenians were also there, and there is one beautiful symmetry of Dutch and Armenians in present day Surat also. So it was a hub for the trading communities. It was also called a window towards the west due to the numbers of trades executed. If we talk about some of the battles happened in Surat, one of the battles is Battle of Suwali, where British came, fought with Portuguese, threw them out, and established their first trading center. So now you can see Surat was particularly very focused city for also the country and the Gujarat. If we talk about the event which shook Surat, so let me speak about that. What caused the outrage and boycott in Surat? With this background, it is fine that we can move forward. So in 1669, when Surat was ruled by Aurangzeb centrally in Delhi, Surat Qazi Nazruddin took support of some fanatic Muslims to forcibly convert two Hindu and one Jain boy to Islam. So at that time, if some conversion happens, then it was impossible to get them back. And there was so much social disdain for the people who converted. So one among them committed suicide later. So Mahajans, the people outside Gujarat may not have some idea about Mahajans. So let me give some context about Mahajans. So it was a body of traders, merchants, and businessmen to consensually take decisions regarding which business to do, which business not to do, which type of people one should deal with, which type of people one should not deal with, which type of debt can lead to bankruptcy, and which type of debt is not bankruptcy. All these decisions were taken by the Mahajan. So Mahajan was a judiciary also, it was a representative body also. So sometimes Mahajan king to request that, we want to execute this trade and this can help the treasury of the state. So you give some tax relaxation to us, and etc. Such type of deals were being done through the Mahajans. So Bhimji Parekh took the lead to revolt against Aurangzeb. So this was not a particular revolution which we see and read in the books. So Bhimji Parekh had his stronghold over the Vaishnav Mahajans. So he gave the call of boycott. Virji Vora, who was the contemporary of him, he had his stronghold over the Jain Mahajans. So he extended the support. So now both the best businessmen of the city gave this call. Surat totally became silent. Shops, main custom house were shut down on the call of 7th September 1669. So for 3 days or something, it was possible to get vegetables, fruits, and the daily items of daily necessity. But after, it became very very difficult to get it. At this time, this merchant wrote to the governor of Bombay that, see, we need to come there. We want to do business there. But the governor of Bombay suggested that the Bombay is not fortified yet. And there are continuous raids on us. So we can't give you refuge. You can go to the Bharuj. So this was the event which hit the final nail in the coffin. This happened after 15 days when the 8,000 merchants migrated to Bharuj for better opportunities on the part of boycott. Now Aurangzeb saw that the city has been totally became silent. Their source of revenue have become almost zero from Surat, because custom houses in the times of Aurangzeb, what was the system? The custom houses, he used to give it on lease. Some traders would take it, collect the taxes and give it back to the Aurangzeb. But custom houses were shut, so there was no source of revenue to Aurangzeb from this city. So this Mahajans started building pressure on Aurangzeb that you need to apologize. You need to take surety of our religious freedom. If this doesn't happen, then we are going to execute our all threats through Bharuj. Bharuj is just the north of Surat, something 60-70 kilometer north to Surat. And it is also connected nearly to river Narmada and the Arabian Sea. So all these and the Gulf of Cambay was also near. So these particular events caused Aurangzeb to apologize in December 1669, and he also took the surety of the religious freedom. Like, see, this is Surat. No such type of events will be tolerated here. And after this surety, the merchants gradually started shifting their base from Bharuj to Surat. So historian Makrand Mehta, who has done his extensive research on the history of entrepreneurs and merchants of Gujarat, is called it as the first mercantile strike and the first entirely non-violent movement. So the year is also the coincidental, like 1669, 200 years before Mahatma Gandhi was born. So when he put these ideas of Satyagraha in front of people, they were not alien to him. Like, Gujarat has already seen such movements even before his birth. So let us dwell something more about the people who were pivotal in this movement. First one is the Veerji Vora. English East India Company's documents call him as the richest merchant of the world at that particular time. So this one is a graphic by one publication. Let me give some introduction about it. He was born in 1590 and he died in 1670s. He was a Jain trader from Surat, although there are some sources which describe him as a Hindu and Muslim, which seem unlikely because he had so much stronghold over the Jain Mahajans. And he was so much authoritative figure on Jain scripture that if some youth wanted to take diksha, which is the basically renunciation from the worldly desires in Jainism, then they used to be sent to Veerji Vora. Veerji Vora would be asking questions based on scriptures, and then the final call whether they need to be given diksha or not were taken by the saints. So this seems unlikely that he was Hindu or Muslim. he had wealth of rupees 80 lakhs at that time, and his main business was money lending, which is giving credits to various traders like Dutch, English, French, etc. And he was also in the wholesale trading business. He used to trade in paper, then textile, and many such things. He was a lender to the English East India Company, then Dutch East India Company, also the French, but he was also the competitor. So when we put this type of the things forward, then comes that this entrepreneur's greed was responsible why British are here, British came to India, but it was not the case. Like, this lending was happening very frequently in between the different types of entrepreneurs and in different types of entrepreneurial community also. Like, they used to give loans to Parsis, and Parsis used to give some loans to Dutch, and Dutch used to give loans to English, and such type of transactions were more frequent there. So this is some introduction about Veerji Vora. Let us talk about his business empire and some particular trades which he had done and created his fortune. He was a bank and a company himself. His business had location in various parts of India, and as well as in the port cities of Persian Gulf, Red Sea, and Southeast Asia. His agents, if we talk about his agents, then they were located in all the important and important commercial centers such as Agra, which was a pivotal for indigo trade, Burhanpur, which was paramount for the transportation and textiles, Golconda in Andhra Pradesh, which is for the spices, Goa, which is for the coastal trade, Calicut, which is also for the coastal trade. And he was a very prominent figure for the Malabari trade. So he also had his agents in Bihar, obviously, because the Bengal was near to Bihar, and he could transfer his messages or his royalty to the Nawab of Bengal at that time. Within Gujarat, his agents are present in towns like Ahmedabad, Vadodara, and Bharuch. Let us talk about his some successful trades. In 1625, he bought the paper stock from the Dutch. So Dutch bought this from the Malabar. They came to Surat, and he purchased the entire stock. This was to be directly sold to the English by the Dutch. But then something happened that English delayed payment to them. So Veerji Vora went there, took entire stock with him, and then sold it to the higher price to the English in 1625. Then in 1648, he bought cloves from the Dutch and the English. He bought the entire cloves from the Dutch and English at rupees 45 per mound. Mound is approximately 20 kilograms. So he bought at rupees 45 per mound and sold at some hefty profit at rupees 62 to 65 per mound. Then a year later, he bought all the nutmegs and mace available in the market. And one documenter has written that he had so much nutmegs and mace that it can feed entire country. So these were some pigments and industrial elements. So he captured them. Then a year later, in 1650, he bought some stock of tea, like 20 mound stock of tea he bought and 8 mound stock of coffee he bought. This was the time when tea and coffee were not popular in India. So it was obviously the question, like, how will he offload them? So he started popularizing them in Surat's elites. He used to share tea with English and Dutch and French. And then he slowly started offloading his stock of tea and coffees. So you can see that Veerji Vora is something entrepreneur who popularized trends even at that time. He was also a lender. So this was the personality which extended his support to this boycott movement. So one can imagine how much stronghold he had over the economy of Surat and overall economy of Gujarat and India. So now let us talk more about Bhimji Parekh. Who was the original one who led the struggle? He was also the first entrepreneur to Indian entrepreneur to import the machinery of printing press to India. This is some visual created by one publication. Let us give some introduction. He lived between 1610 to 1686. He was son to Tulsidas Parekh. Tulsidas Parekh was also a lender to East India Company. He was a Hindu Vaishnav Baniya by caste, and he has had his hold over the Vaishnav Madam. When he passed away, he had two underage sons. Then one of his grandson married to a Jain lady, and they got converted to Jainism. So descendants of Bhimji Parekh are still living and they follow Jainism in Surat. So let us talk about the business empire of him. So he was a money lender to East India Company in Surat. He lended so much money that he was awarded in 1683 a medal for his services to the company. He was also the first Indian entrepreneur to purchase the machineries regarding the printing press for quote unquote the common good of printing quote unquote ancient manuscript that could be useful or at least grateful to posterity in 1674 to 1675. So in a letter from Surat to East India Company dated 9th January 1670, Bhimji Parekh requested the East India Company to import the printing machine in India, basically in Bombay. So in 1670s, there is one more letter which gets appeared in which Parekh mentioned clearly in a letter that he wished to print ancient Brahminiya writings. So he wanted to print the scriptures so that it can be promoted. Henry Hills, the expert printer that was finally arrived in India, but it did not have the expertise to curve the Indic scripts. That texter was missing. So he requested for the type founder. He repeatedly pleaded to British that I need this type of the type founder, which has the Indic script, so I can print about our manuscript. But British were naturally not interested in them. So he failed about it. So this was about the entrepreneurs and their struggles against Aurangzeb. These are some of the good references which one should read. The Makrand Mehta's Indian Merchants and Entrepreneurs in Historical Perspective is actually a good read regarding this one. If we talk about the Jains in India by Gopal Surendra, it is also a good source to understand about the Jain entrepreneurs. And then the Arabian Seas, the Indian Ocean World of the 17th century, give some good perspective about how the trades were used to be executed. So these are some of the good references about this topic.
I just have a comment about something you mentioned earlier about one of the traders, Veerji Vora, and you said that he had a wealth of information about Jainism and people used to come to him. So he was more likely Jain than Hindu. But my understanding is that Sanatan Dharma is like a broad umbrella under which there are different parts of which one of the ones is Jain Dharma. And given Hindu is actually not one of the terms we use to describe ourselves, but outsiders do, perhaps they saw him as Hindu because everyone following that kind of a tradition is Hindu. I wanted to understand where you were coming from in saying he's Jain, but he was likely not Hindu. Where is that coming from?
Yes, so actually when we refer to Hindu trading communities, so they are basically Mod Vaniyas, Kapol Vaniyas and Bhatiyas. And when we talk about the Jain trading communities, then they also in Hindu trading communities, there are Agarwals. But we specifically mention about Jain trading communities, then there are Korwals, Srimalis and Agarwals. So these are some Jain trading communities. So if we talk about Hindu and Muslim, which he was referred. So again, as you mentioned, this was mostly by the Britishers, British historian, which mentioned him as the Hindu and Muslim. But if we talk about the Jain scriptures, then we find the mention that he was particularly Jain. So if I refer that he was not a Hindu, that is in the context that he was not a Kapol Vanya, he was not a Mod Vanya or the Bhatia. He was not hailing from those trading communities. So I'm sorry if it causes you some confusion.
Not at all. Please don't apologize. I just wanted to understand the two different communities you mentioned. Sorry, I can't remember the names. I'm not as informed as you about them. But you said one set were Hindus, one set were Jain, and you described them differently. What set them apart? Just so I can understand better.
So basically, their way of worshipping, like if you mention about the Mod Baniya and Kapol Baniya communities, so they tend to believe in the Pushti Mark. They worship Shri Krishna. If we mention about Bhatiyas and Lavanas, then they also believe in the Pushti Mark sometimes, but they also believe in the ocean. But if we talk about specifically Jain trading communities, then they believe in the Tirthankaras, their teachings, and the whole way of Jainism. So that's how they are set apart.
The other thing I wanted to ask is, when you said that these traders decided to boycott and they were trying to find other opportunities while they were boycotting in Surat because of the conversion and all the things that were happening, how did the other people in their communities who were not traders feel about it? I mean, did they understand that this boycott had a bigger plan to protest against conversion? Because they started facing the consequences of not having product available, goods and products available, you know, everyday things when the boycott happened, because it went on for a while. How was their response to the traders versus their response to Aurangzeb, and what role did they play?
There is no detailed documentation regarding what was the response of the common people who were not traders and what was their response. Because most of the sources with these scholars like Makran Mehta and Surendra Gopal have studied are the text related documents at the time of Mughals in the royal court. Also the some religious documents like some Jain text which mentions about that. So obviously they have some one-sided view regarding this. So there is no detailed documentation regarding what people have played. So there might be some sources which need to be explored. We should try to explore those sources. This is a very good question. But at present, I do not think I have studied their detailed response from the normal public.
Thank you. That answers it, because I was just keen to know whether they threw their support behind the traders, seeing the big plan and picture, or did they just protest against it, making it worse? And what led to Aurangzeb then apologizing? Because that's a huge thing in itself.
Correct.
So Harshil, just a follow-up of Aditi's question. So these were two distinct trading communities in Gujarat, Jain and Vaishnav. So was there a difference in their dealing in business, these two communities, or it was same?
So if we speak religiously, then Jain science basically prevent the ivory trade and such type of the trades. But if we see in the practice, then this difference gets disappeared mainly. If we talk about Veerji Vora, then he was involved in the ivory trade, although he had influence over the Jain Mahajans. Then if we talk about Sheth Hadishinji, who was a trader in the 19th century in Gujarat, he was a very big person involved in the opium wars. If we talk practically, then there is no difference. But if we talk that how they should deal in business, then yes, religiously, there exists difference.
And that means there was a lot of money coming in Gujarat with the help of these traders. Did that help the society to grow as well? Or was it only with the traders?
There is one anecdote which I want to share. Like one Portuguese traveler came to Surat in the 17th century and he saw a weird hospital. So that hospital, he writes in his book that hospital is dedicated to animals like cows, buffaloes, and even insects. They are being performed surgery. So, this was not concentrated with the traders. These traders were donors also. Some used to keep money with themselves. So if we talk about the raids of Shivaji in Surat, so he plundered it twice in 1670 and some 3 or 4 years later. So this was the time when Virji Vora was also alive and Bhimji Parekh was alive. So Bhimji Parekh was a very philanthropic man. So Shivaji's men did not touch his property. Shivaji instructed them not to touch his property. But if we talk about Virji Vora, then first time he was completely diminished. Then he rose from the scratch. And the second time he was totally plundered. So after 3 or 4 years, he went to the Suwali, started living life silently. And at 1 or 2 years later, he died. So disappeared from the pages of history. So it depends on the trader to trader also, like what they used to do with money.
So with all that business going on in Gujarat, there was no anger against the British or Dutch in the society, because I think it started from Bengal and Punjab and other states did rise up to fight against the capturing of their first the British started capturing the small landowners, then slowly they took over the states. So in Gujarat, was there any uprising of that sort, or people were happy with all the business?
Not exactly. Like if you talk about the 1683 or something, there was one Englishman who borrowed money from Bhimji Parekh, saying that he will fortify the Surat so that the Maratha raids can be prevented. But he did not do so. So at that time also, the merchants went on strike against the British. And then this particular person was arrested. So we need to see it in the context. Like, we are talking with the time when the British did not have any political interest to control or to interfere in their day-to-day life. They were also the competitors. If we talk about Virji Vora, then he had so many capital that he used to bought all the all the stocks of commodities available. But if we talk some 100 years later and 125 years later, then yeah, there were some dissatisfaction because the businessmen and merchants were getting exploited. They did not have capital. Britishers had some policy like, we will not allow the import here. We will collect the customs from this. So at this time, which we are dealing, there is no visible anger against the Britishers as a whole, because these communities were used to with such trading influences happening from last 100 or some 150 years. Ki hum trade kar rahe hain, we are dealing with traders and they are just normal traders. We will compete with them. So retrospectively, it may feel that it was something unnatural. But if we take the time period from 1500 or 1550 to this time, then it may seem very natural that this was a normal process in the trade.
This is a different one, Harshilji. I'm so sorry if I misheard or misunderstood one part where you mentioned that because of the boycott, the traders were going to the Maharashtra region to do trade there.
Correct.
And then the people in Maharashtra, I think they said you can't do it here for some reasons. Could you clarify why they felt
that? Basically, they wrote a letter to British because British were also the trading communities, and British started developing Bombay. So they particularly mentioned that we want to shift to Bombay, but Bombay was also getting attacked by the Marathas at that time, and Bombay was not fortified. So that's why British told them that, see, you can't come here because it is not fortified. Even we are not secure. So how can we take the surety of your security? So that's why they moved to the something northern of Surat in Bharuch.
So I was wondering why they didn't turn to the Marathas, and why didn't the Marathas throw support behind them? Is it because at the time Marathas didn't see the British and the other traders from outside India, you know, from other community groups as danger to the Indian subcontinent?
I actually do not have much study about the Marathas' mindset and what might have caused them for their actions. So I cannot elaborate more about this viewpoint.